The people along the sand all turn and look one way. They turn their back on the land and look at the sea all day. As long as it takes to pass, a ship keeps raising its hull. The wetter ground like glass reflects a silent goal. Now, the land may vary more, but whatever the case may be, the water comes to the shore, and the people look at the sea. Now, they cannot look out far, and they cannot look in deep, but when was there ever a bar to any watch of the keep? The reason I bring up Robert Frost's poem is that he's talking about a chaotic system, the chaotic system that is known as the ocean. Now, the left hemisphere of our brain is like a black and white television. It's where we experience the world, our relationships, our feelings. And our right hemisphere of the brain is like a big three-dimensional bubble with colors and shapes and all sorts of things. This is where our imagination and visions and ideas come from. The reason that I brought up the poem is that the left hemisphere of the brain does not want to allow a human being to see large chaotic systems. However, the right hemisphere of the brain looks at the ocean and it says, I see the pattern. I see what's going on there. And the left hemisphere of the brain says, too much information. I don't want to hurt my brain. I don't want to get upset. So we're drawn to the ocean because of that conflict between the left and the right hemisphere of the brain. What I'm going to do over the course of the next 20 minutes is show you the chaotic system that is known as mankind. The famous sports writer for the Chicago Tribune, Blackie Schrod, stated, the reason history must repeat itself is because we pay so little attention to it the first time. In Solomon we read, the thing that has been is that which shall be, and that which shall be is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said? See, this is new. It has already been of old times which was before us. Now, in 1991, Strauss and Howe wrote a book titled Generations. And what they were doing is they were, in fact, looking for the chaotic nature of time, the chaotic nature of mankind. They were looking for that system. And what they determined by researching the last 400 years of recorded Western civilization was that, in fact, there are four 20-year generational patterns, a civic, adaptive, idealistic, and reactive cycles. Now, this presentation was initially developed by a gentleman by the name of Roy H. Williams. He's known as the Wizard of Ads. He actually founded a nonprofit school out of Austin, Texas called the Wizard Academy, and I'm fortunate to be doing this presentation on their behalf for you today. And I also want to thank the authors of this book, Generation Strauss and Howe. Anyway, Roy Williams is a strong evangelical Christian. And when he was reading this book, he said, you know what, I see that there are these patterns going on, but it can't be four 20-year cycles, but rather it has to be two 40-year patterns. You see, in the Old Testament alone, there are more than 160 mentions of 40-year generational patterns. As an example, Moses was 40 years old when he was kicked out of Egypt. And he was kicked out of Egypt because he killed an Egyptian slave master who killed the Hebrew slave. He was the prince of Egypt. He acted like the prince of Egypt. He did what he wanted to do when he wanted to do it. And when he returned to Egypt, he was 80 years old. And what did he return to do? To free the people. And we know that in the 40 years between when he left Egypt and when he returned, he changed so much that he stuttered. He couldn't even speak for himself. His half-brother Aaron had to be his mouthpiece. And to allow a generation to die off for worshiping a false golden calf, God punished the Israelites to wander the wilderness for 40 years. Now, what's interesting about the book Generations is about two-thirds of the way through the book, they actually admit that there are two dominant and two recessive cycles. The civic and idealistic cycle are the dominant cycles, and the adaptive and reactive cycles are the recessive cycles. Now, I come from the book publishing industry. And in the industry, I find if there's a problem in communication, it's based on a lack of shared values or a lack of shared definition. So for the purpose of this presentation, let me define for you what I mean and what they meant in the book Generations when they say generation. If you define a generation as people born between this year, that won't work for this presentation. Rather, a generation is the predominant worldview of society as a whole. It's the lens through which we look and how we make our decisions and how we value each other. It's the carrot at the end of the stick that we chase, but it changes every 40 years. What will that new carrot be? Well, we most certainly know that it'll be brought to us by the youth. Now, the way that we reconcile the book Generations with Roy's philosophy on two 40-year cycles is by looking at this like a pendulum. And a pendulum will start off at point zero. It'll swing up to its zenith. The gravity will pull back down. Momentum will pull back up. and gravity back down, and back and forth and back and forth. So what we're talking about here is the pendulum of the forces that move our world. And we start every cycle, every 40-year cycle, in a civic cycle. Now, in a civic cycle, it's not about big dreams. It's about small actions. It's not about going to the moon, but rather it's about going across the street and giving that poor homeless guy something to eat. Now, in 1923, we began our last civic cycle. And in 1923, we see the birth of the Salvation Army. What happened was the women of the Salvation Army wanted to do something for the members of the military serving overseas. So what they did was they made donuts, and they mailed those donuts to the members of the military serving overseas. This one small civic action of making and giving donuts is what birthed the Salvation Army into the internationally recognized organization that it is today. Now, 10 years into the last civic cycle, which was 1933, we see in the U.S., the government cracked down on alcohol and tobacco, because in a civic cycle, it's about what's doing best for society as a whole. And of course, alcohol and tobacco have to be bad for society as a whole, so they had prohibition in the United States. And we also see that the U.S. government cracked down on organized crime. Now, what's interesting about 1933 also is that FDR's fireside chats were the most listened to radio show and what was considered the golden age of radio, because FDR was getting people in North America together as one giant national family to sit down in their living rooms and to address their problems, just like each of us would with our own families when addressing our own family problems. Now, by 20 years into the cycle, we're at the zenith of the last civic cycle. And at that point, we've become a society that is highly regimented and highly conformed. And the youth of society become the gravity that start to pull us back down the other way. We find in 1943, the height of the last civic cycle, Bob Hope. Now, I couldn't find a better image of this, but typically speaking, when Bob Hope would entertain the troops serving overseas, he would dress in army fatigues. And the reason that he would do this is that he was just doing his part. He wasn't better or worse than the members of the military serving overseas. He was just doing his part by entertaining them. That's what happens at the height of a civic cycle. We lose a little bit of our self-identity, and we really focus on the community. Now, what's interesting about every major civic cycle is that we're faced with some major internal issue, say the Great Depression or the current recession that we're in, or some major external issue, say World War II or the current war on terror. When we look back at this current civic cycle, as we're in a civic cycle now, it'll be interesting to see what our primary focus becomes. 30 years into every cycle, we should see alphas emerge in literature and technology. An alpha is someone who's predicting what's going to happen in the next cycle. So we're looking for alphas to predict what it's going to be like in the next idealistic or individualistic cycle. So in 1953, we see the release of J.D. Salinger's critically acclaimed book, A Catcher in the Rye. Basically, Holden Caulfield was a kid who rejected his family. He rejected his society, he rejected his government, and he went out and did his own thing. And the youth of society in 1953 were so ready for this message. There was so much regimentation, so much conformity in society, that this book sold more than 26 million copies in 1953, and the population in North America was one-third smaller than it is today. Now, I've personally placed 64 books on the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, Business Week, and New York Times bestsellers list, and I don't believe collectively that I've sold 26 million copies. But again, this message so resonated with the youth of society in 1953 that the book sold 26 million copies. Also released in 1953 was a little book by a gentleman by the name of Jack Kerouac, titled On the Road. Basically, it was largely autobiographical book about Jack Kerouac's drug-induced adventures through middle century America. He was Holden Caulfield. And he's also credited as the father of the beatnik generation. Most musicians from the 60s and 70s attribute much of their inspiration to Jack Kerouac. Again, he was breaking away from the chain. He was breaking away from his family, from his society, and from his government. And again, the youth of society in 1953 were so ready for this message that the book sold more than 29 million copies. Then 35 years into the cycle, 5 years before the tipping point, we should see an alpha emerge in music. Chuck Berry was the real innovator of rock and roll, but our society in 1958 was too racist to allow a black man to be the purveyor of our next type of music. So we had to find a white man to sing a black man's music, and we found him in Tupelo, Mississippi, in Elvis Presley. And then we completed a full 40-year civic cycle. And momentum from the alphas will start to pull us back up the other way. In an idealistic cycle, it is about looking good. It is about self-expression. It's about believing that you can be whatever you want to be. At the beginning of the last idealistic cycle in 1963, the old modality of the previous civic cycle was still prevalent. You see, once we hit year zero in either direction, it takes 7 years for society as a whole to adopt the new mindset. And in 1963, the Beatles, even though that was considered a long haircut, all had the exact same haircut. If you go back and watch A Hard Day's Night or listen to their original albums, they're wearing suits and ties, and again, that old modality of the civic cycle is prevalent. But within just 4 short years, everything changed. We see the Beatles go psychedelic. We see Bob Dylan plug in. Of course, Jimi Hendrix burned up on the stage and then burned out. And then 10 years into the tipping point, after the tipping point, 10 years before the idealistic cycle reaches its zenith, we see the release of the book, I'm Okay, You're Okay, which sits at the zenith as one of the top selling self-help books of all time. And what does the book say? I'm okay, you're okay. If you're a 5'2" white guy who thinks you could be the next Michael Jordan, well, by golly, just go and do it. If you believe it, you can do it. And then we hit 1983, the zenith, the height of the last idealistic cycle. And whose critically acclaimed album was released in 1983? But Michael Jackson's Thriller. Can you think of anyone more plastic than Michael Jackson? And of course, must have his queen. And whose first album was released in 1983? Madonna. And as the song says, in 1983, at the height of the idealistic cycle, we were living in a material world, and she was our material girl. So 30 years into the cycle, 10 years before the tipping point, we should see an alpha emerge in literature and technology. And sometimes they're together. Contrary to what Al Gore says, AOL was the real purveyor of the internet. Starting in 1993, we can all remember receiving those really annoying CDs and DVDs in the mail, trying to get us to sign up for 500 or 1,000 or 2,000 minutes on AOL. And then we're 35 years into the cycle, 5 years before the tipping point, 1998. We should see an alpha emerge in music. But even as recently as just 12 years ago, our society was still too racist to allow a black man to be the purveyor of our next type of music. So again, we had to find a white man, and we found him in Eminem. And then we'll complete a full 40-year idealistic cycle. Now, once we hit year zero again, in either direction, it takes about 7 years in either direction for society as a whole to adopt the new mindset. The most recent switch into this civic cycle began in 2003. So by the beginning of this year, whether you understood it or not, society as a whole has adopted this new civic mindset. In their second book, Strauss and Howe stated, and this is titled The Fourth Turning, around World War II, we were proud as a people, but modest as individuals. Fewer than 2 people in 10 said yes when asked, are you a very important person? Today, more than 6 in 10 say yes. Where we once thought ourselves as collectively strong, we now regard ourselves as individually entitled. Posted online in 1999, the Clutrain Manifesto stated, in just a few more years, the current homogenized voice of business, the sound of mission statements and brochures, will seem as contrived and artificial as the language of the 18th century French court. Getting a sense of humor does not mean putting some jokes on the corporate website. Rather, it requires big values, straight talk, and a genuine point of view. So now that we've hit this tipping point, what exactly does that mean? How will the future be different than the past? And what are driving these changes? YouTube, Facebook, and Google are the Kerouac, Dean, and Salinger of this new generation. Where baby boomers rejected conformity, today's civic generation reject pretense. Born into a world of hype, their internal BS meters are highly sensitive and blisteringly accurate. Words like amazing, astounding, and spectacular are translated as blah, 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 blah. Consequently, tried and true selling methods that worked as recently as 2 years ago are working far less well today. So what exactly are the forces at work? Hope you don't live in Mayberry no more. Childhood's innocent mischief is nearing an extinction, which is an unanticipated side effect in the explosion in technology. Tom Sawyer and Huckleberry Finn have become dusty icons of an earlier North America. Today's kids are finding it harder to relate to the drawings of Norman Rockwell. Most kids have never sat at that Thanksgiving table, played marbles, or gone skinny dipping. Today's kids are a savvy, streetwise generation that was never given a chance to be naive. The principal changes taking place are these. Number one, word of mouth has grown into the muscular beast known as interconnectivity, and it moves with lightning speed. Technology is rewriting the rules of commerce. Online chat rooms, blogs, and instant messaging are ensuring that whether good or bad, the word gets out. Number two, we're moving into an era of transparency in which it will become harder than ever to win new customers through PR and advertising alone. In today's civic cycle, you're going to have to begin delivering all that you promise in your marketing materials. Claims of biggest and best mean nothing when you have customers who have friends who are telling them otherwise. The new trend in decision to purchase is based on shared values and an alignment of perspective between buyer and seller. Today's customers aren't just buying what you're selling. They're buying who you are. So how can you apply this knowledge and build a civic conscious organization that will succeed over the course of the next 33 years? Let me give you 7 tips that you can take. Number one, refer to things in your marketing material that you know your customer has experienced. Number one, refer to things in your marketing materials that you know your customer has experienced. Number two, deliver to your customer exactly the experience you promised them. Number two, deliver to your customer exactly the experience you promised them. Number three, evaluate what you're doing to make a difference. And when I say evaluate what you're doing to make a difference, I don't mean, yeah, my business gives back. I don't mean, hey, we donate money to a nonprofit. No, your customers are looking to you to see what it is that you're doing to give back personally. So number three, evaluate what you're doing to make a difference. Number four, make it easy on your website. I can't tell you about the number of convoluted, complex websites that I see out of the marketplace. Your customers do not have the time to figure out what it is you're saying or what it is you're selling. If you're not making it clear and obvious, your website's not going to work. So make it easy on your website. But of course, this presupposes that you have a website, right? If you don't have a website, you have two choices. You can get a website, or you can pack up and go home. Not having a website is like not having a mailing address, not having a phone number, not having an email address. So number four, make it easy on your website, assuming that you have a website. Number five, don't wee-wee all over yourself. And when I say wee-wee, your customer wants to know about you. They want to develop a relationship with you, but they don't want you to tell them how great you are. Your customer wants to know what you're going to do for them. Make sure that you're careful in your copy to tell your customer what it is that you're going to do for them. Number six, when available, include raw, unscripted testimonials. Now, I come from the book industry, and I see endorsements all the time for books by big name authors that say things like, this is the best book since the Bible. This is the best thing since sliced bread. And you know what? It means nothing to the customers. I would rather see an endorsement that said from a no-name person that says, you know what? Hated it. Hated 90% of the book. But that final 10% made the book worth its weight in gold. Roy H. Williams will say, if you were to call him to ask if you should hire me, he would say, yeah, absolutely hire Mike. But when you hire Mike, make sure that you also buy a red brick, because at some point you're going to want to throw it at his head. It's a really true endorsement of who I am. My job when I work with a client is not to be nice. My role is to get my clients to do things that they wouldn't otherwise do. So again, when available, include raw, unscripted testimonials. And number seven, put someone in charge of studying the practical applications of new media. And when I say new media, I mean social media. I mean Facebook. I mean Twitter. I mean ping.fm. I mean peoplepond.com. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you're either going to hire someone to do that for you, or guess what? You just found a new job. And for those of you watching this who still question the efficacy and value of social media, well, let me share a little message with you from Eric Qualman. Reverberations of the baby boomers fade over the horizon. We're beginning to hear the sound of the new branding and promotion, the new marketing, and it's the sound of real. Today's customers aren't just hungry for what you're selling, they're hungry for who you are. I think Carl Rogers said it best when he said, "What I am is good enough, if only I would be it openly. And what you are is good enough too. Be it openly." Thank you.